Welcome everyone to our April webinar here at GL Communications. This one is on SNMP alarm monitoring for telecom networks. We're excited to present this to you. We've done some recent SNMP enhancements to some of our products, to GL's products, and this webinar will touch on those things and give you just a general understanding of some key SNMP elements. My name is Matt Yost. I'll be the moderator and do a little bit of the presenting. I'll be joined by a couple colleagues. One of them is Vijay Kulkarni, and the other is Alan Revson. Quickly now, to just start the webinar, we'll get right into the agenda. So our agenda for today will be, we're just going to, at the beginning here, we're going to talk about SNMP and what it is. We've heard of SNMP traps before. What are those? There's some other things called MIBs and OIDs. We'll discuss those, kind of generalize on what those are, what those elements are, and how they're important in the SNMP world. We're going to have some focus on SNMP version 2 and a little touching on version 3, which is later. SNMP messaging. Then we're going to get into some of the telco type things, so DS3, DS1, SONET, MIBS, and how these analyzer products that GL Communications manufactures, how SNMP is related to that and where we're using SNMP. We'll talk about MIB browsers, a MIB tree, MIB libraries, and just general DS3 alarms, T3, DS3 alarms, as well as DS1 and T1E1 alarms. And very quickly, we'll probably give you a little theory of operation on the whole SNMP environment. So at the beginning here, what we're going to do is, the way the webinar will be focused, it's kind of at the beginning, we're going to talk about what is SNMP and what are these key elements of SNMP. After that, we'll show you a little bit about a project that we did, and we'll give you some insight on what that project was about and how it involved our T3 analyzer. So here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn over the presentation for a few slides here to Vijay Kulkarni. Vijay, go ahead.
Okay, thank you, Matt. Thank you very much. Welcome everybody. I hope you're all doing very well, and I'm very excited to give you this presentation about our SNMP project that we recently did for several of our customers. And I have some experts here to help me, Alan and of course Matt. Simple Network Management Protocol. That's the actual acronym. Believe it or not, it was developed in the late 1980s. That's amazing. I don't know of any high technology products that are that long-lived, but SNMP seems to have a very, very long life, and it seems to be very pervasive. It was implemented with some serial communications protocols early on, because we know that 1980s is pre-Ethernet technology, and it's pre-wireless revolution. In fact, it's almost pre-PC. So something like SNMP to have survived for this long really is kind of amazing to me, anyway, who has been in this technology field for so long. So that was one of the things that surprised me when we introduced these products into our products, when we introduced the SNMP Foundation into our products. So as I said, it is used pervasively and it's being expanded, and it's used for managing networks. Now, we know the definition of networks is expanding. First, it used to be wide area networks like the telephone networks, the telco networks. Now it also includes local area networks, enterprise networks, metropolitan area networks. And sure enough, SNMP has absorbed all of those devices and transmission and network media to encompass all of those devices. So anything from switches, multiplexers from the old world, to servers, hubs, routers, printers, operating systems, databases, virtual products that can be managed or controlled or provide alarms has been encompassed into SNMP. So that's really truly amazing. And the whole SNMP world, if you are building a device, you will probably make it manageable by your customers, because they may have multitude of devices in their network, and they want to be able to manage and control all of those devices, whether it's yours, someone else's, and in fact, the number of devices in a network can be quite large and quite, as you will see here. So as Ethernet technology has progressed, SNMP has also migrated to that transmission technology, and the primary transport mechanism of Ethernet IP UDP is used by SNMP for the majority of practical implementations. So almost every device, every agent, or every network management system will utilize SNMP and its simple protocol to exchange information, control information, alarm information, status information via this IP UDP structure. Now, so it has become the de facto standard by, and it is also recommended by the Internet Activities Board, which has a sort of is kind of supervising activities over the Internet. They generally recommend that all network devices be network manageable to some extent. And of course, it depends on the device manufacturer how much of the capability he wants to implement. But there is a very large infrastructure within SNMP that can be utilized to rapidly build an SNMP compatible product, and also to be able to incorporate that. Now, what is SNMP? Let's get into some of the specifics of SNMP. Actually, it's a very simple protocol, just as the name designates. There are essentially two types of messages, the polling type, which is GET and a response, and that is from the SNMP manager. The SNMP manager here is shown as a human being, but it's really a piece of software that resides within a large network management system. Since a network management system may have other responsibilities other than just communicating with all the devices. So SNMP manager is usually a component of a network management system. But specifically, SNMP has essentially two types of messages. This polling type, where actively the SNMP manager queries an SNMP device, which is controlled, or which is being monitored by an SNMP agent. So every device manufacturer will build an SNMP, either a rudimentary or a complicated SNMP agent that is monitoring or allows control of or provides status of the information associated with that device. And now, it's also possible that that device may not be queried, but on its own, asynchronously, will provide alarm information or some sort of trap. So the word trap is used because of the nature of the way that, that the device recognizes that there's some abnormal or anomalous event occurred at that device. So those, of course, cannot be predictable. And as soon as those happen, the agent will recognize that and send asynchronously a packet, an IP UDP packet, describing that event, and that we call a trap. So essentially, those are the two types of messages. One is sort of a poll query type. The other is this trap or alert or notification sometimes that's used. Now, this whole, because of the multitude of devices that are out there in a network, we're talking about literally thousands of different kinds of devices that a network is composed of, and also that list is growing every day. Each device manufacturer will try to adhere to the structure of SNMP. And the way they do that is using this MIB, Management Information Base, which is usually the attributes. It's a collection of attributes of a managed network device. Now, most network devices are very well defined, a router, a multiplexer, a printer, something as simple as a printer, for example, a T1 or DS1, T1 DS1 are synonymous, device. So we know what their behaviors are, and they've been around for tens of years, 10, 20, 30 years. So that is a technology that is very well defined. So if you're building a product for one of those types of legacy products, or even a router or a new product, they're more than likely 99% of the information that an agent would collect would be already defined, and that those attributes are already defined, and that's in this management information base, and that is both a machine readable and a human readable ASCII file. And that makes life very easy, as you will see here. It makes life very easy for the SNMP manager, because the device manufacturer will use that management information base to build his agent. His agent may be very simple, in which case he may be just, for example, only provide essential alarms, detect essential alarms like out of service, power outage, alarms that may be happening on some circuits or some overload or CPU utilization, whatever. So he might make it very simple, or he can look into that management information base and look at the umpteen different attributes that are possible to control, provide status for, and to the SNMP manager. So it can be a very complicated SNMP agent, or it could be a very simple one. That the information and the way it is organized and the brevity in which it is exchanged with the SNMP manager, each attribute has a object identifier, and it is part of this large structure, and it is a very brief way of communicating that attribute and the values of that attribute. So that's called the object identifier, and we'll just get into that just a little bit here in just a moment. So again, MIBs are management information base, and they exist for practically every network device that is out there. Me, I'm a sort of old school transmission guy, so I understand DS1, DS3s, SONETs. So those types of MIBs exist. For new school people, like with routers, hubs, bridges, soft switches, you know, whatever, VPN enabled switches, and so on. All of these more or less software-based, hardware-based appliances, they also have MIPS and very well-defined, very encompassing, all-encompassing MIPS, management information bases. So a lot of work has already been done, and each, and as it progresses, SNMP becomes more and more powerful, and I doubt if it will actually be obsoleted. So as I know so far, there are over 7,000 MIBs, management information bases, for practically all manageable devices. And any device manufacturer, it's up to him to decide how much or how little he should implement in his SNMP agent. Okay, so that is sort of the top level overview of what SNMP is. It's a simple protocol, but it has this very brief way of exchanging information that makes it very easy to exchange these attribute information. Okay. All right, so when you take a single device and you incorporate it into a large network, you will have multiple network devices. Like, for example, in this picture, we have a router, a switch, a multiplexer, a printer, something as simple as a printer, and perhaps even discrete alarms, controls, and so on. And these, of course, are things like intrusion, fire, backup systems, and so on. Very, very important types of events, of course, those we're very familiar with, and we definitely want to monitor those. And those are the things that you would normally send asynchronously. And usually these asynchronous events are sent on, if you're familiar with the UDP protocol, they're all based on ports. And asynchronous events are sent to the UDP port 162, that's the destination port. So the SNMP manager will be always listening to UDP port 162 for these asynchronous events, alarms. Usually they're pretty serious. However, things that happen more synchronously or the SNMP manager is interested in querying, those are query response types, and those are these get next, get response type of query exchanges. And those are usually triggered by the SNMP manager. He sends out a query to UDP port 161. These SNMP agents are listening on UDP port 161 and respond with the appropriate information. So there is this communication language that is used. Now, in the network management systems that I'm familiar with, some of these are HP OpenView, Spiceworks, there's one, SolarWinds, for example, is a very popular one. All of these are very large, all-encompassing type of network management systems. They cover both WAN, LAN, and a large variety of devices. These are capable of taking a MIB file. So these MIB files, as you can see there in this picture, a MIB file, management information-based file, that is associated with a network device, is simply loaded into the SNMP manager. By that simple loading process, that network device has conveyed all of the information to that network, the SNMP manager, all of the attributes, because they're all defined in a very specific way. With loading that file, that MIB file, and it may contain many attributes or very few that the SNMP device has implemented, but the SNMP manager can query the agent to see which of those attributes have been implemented. And there may be, in this way, he knows whether he's implemented a lot of these get next, get response status information and control information, or maybe he's only implemented the alarms, for example, the asynchronous alarms. So this MIB file, by loading the MIB file and then querying or discovery process, we determine what that end agent or device has implemented. Of course, most of the work is in the actual agent. When you are a device manufacturer, you're building a router, it's up to you to decide to comply with this MIB framework and to provide this data object identifier. In this object identifier method. So this is how it's done, and obviously there's a few devices here, but it can actually run into hundreds to thousands of devices in a network. So that's That's that. Go on to the next. That's the architecture of the SNMP world. And we want to get a little bit more specific. We've been talking in the abstract here a little bit. So we're going to use the product that we built for a large customer around our protocol analyzers was a very dense alarm notification capability that was SNMP compliant. Allows one to monitor tens of DS3s, which contain hundreds of DS1s, which contain thousands of DS0s. So these are very, for something like a public safety organization which is carrying lots of very critical traffic, they would want to monitor such transmission links and make sure that all of them are active, operating properly, and none of them are in alarm mode. So let's take a look at how something like this, this circuit, a DS3, DS1 interface that may be on a Cisco router, on a multiplexer, or some other device that is managing DS3s, how you would take this and implement it in the SNMP world. Well, first of all, I mentioned that there is something called MIP, Management Information Base. Well, what are those? Those are attributes. So in the DS3 case, let's take a look at what those attributes look like. Those attributes are, is it an M13 type of multiplexer? That's a special kind of framing format for DS3. Is it C-bit parity? Is it channelized, meaning does it carry DS1s and then therefore DS0s, possibly? Or is it unchannelized, reading from the left there? What is the status of that DS3 circuit? What is the clock source? I'm just giving a few. Actually, if you go to the DS3 MIB, you will see something like 75 pages of attributes and definitions of those attributes, very detailed, and essentially human-readable as well as computer-readable. So that's just to give you an example of the attributes that exist in a DS3 MIB file. So that DS3 MIB file is an ASCII file that the SNMP manager would just load, and an SNMP device would comply with and provide some of those attribute information to that SNMP manager. And you would instantly have communication between that device and the SNMP manager, and makes, of course, life a lot easier. So some other DS3 attributes over on the right-hand side that I've listed is remote alarm indication, whether there are loopbacks, what the status of those loopbacks are, if any of those are in alarm condition, circuit identifiers, line coding. So these are all transmission technology terms. If we were dealing with a router, well, those terms would be quite different. They would be router-specific, like whether it implemented whether it was a switch, what kind of a switch, VLAN technology, services, or what protocols within the IP or TCP or UDP layers were implemented. So all of those would be the attributes for a router. And an agent would be essentially collecting those or being able to provide a control or status of those attributes. To be very specific, let's take a look at this. The object identifier is a specific, for this example, let's take DSX3 transmit clock source. So I put there the transmit clock source as one of the attributes. Well, that is an attribute. It would have an object identifier associated with it, which is an integer, and that integer can take on the value of 1, 2, or 3 in this case. Very simple, because this is a simple scalar. It could be an array, because the more complicated attribute, it would have a lot more data associated with it, and you would have to traverse that array to understand all that information. But in this case, it took a very simple example, It could be in loop timing, internal timing, or through timing. If you're a transmission person, you will understand that. So attributes and object identifiers. I hope that's clear.
Vijay, let me interject just for a second and ask you one question.
Okay. Sure.
I wanted to just clearly understand about these MIBs and if this is a regulated thing in a sense, or GL is not reinventing the wheel and making up these attributes as we go when we implement this. Is that correct, or how is that done?
GL as a device manufacturer, for example, we are building this SNMP, this product that is monitoring these thousands of circuits. If we're smart, what we would do is learn what is in the MIB already and reuse. In fact, in DS3, nothing has really changed for the last 20, 30 years. So it would be wise for GL to study that MIB and look at the data that is available there, implement what is necessary for our customers, and not reinvent the wheel. However, if we came up with this new alarm within DS3, which is very rare, I don't think that would happen, we do have the flexibility. We can go to the SNMP authority and create a GL communication specific MIB for DS3. So that avenue is there. It is rarely used unless you have come up with something. We can augment if we have this new alarm or new counter or new attribute that we want to convey. But generally speaking, for most products, 99.9% of the attributes are already defined in the MIB, and the method for conveying that information back and forth is already exists. So our job is easy. Easy in the sense that we know what to implement. How to implement it, of course, is where the ingenuity is. How do we detect all these alarms? And for these thousands of circuits, that's where the ingenuity would be. But the mechanism for detecting, transmitting that information has all been standardized.
That answers it. What that means is that, you know, manufacturer A, who's maybe monitoring a DS3 and is complying with the standard MIB, is going to speak the same language that maybe GL Communications, who is monitoring a DS3, who is applying or using the same MIB. It's all speaking the same language there. Everybody can, back to the manager, it's all equal in that sense.
Exactly. Exactly. Okay. That's what makes this network management, the scope and the level of difficulty of network management with these hundreds, thousands of devices, somewhat manageable. And because you don't want to reinvent the wheel. You want to comply with the standards that are there, all of the attributes that have already been defined. There's nothing new under the sun in as far as DS3 is concerned. Of course, as new products are developed, they will have different attributes and characteristics that have to be incorporated into the SNMP architecture, and that is being constantly done. And that is one of the reasons why SNMP has evolved, survived, and continues to do so. And I presume that something like SolarWinds is a very, I think, a popular network or SNMP manager. SNMP manager is part of that component of SolarWinds. It's very easy to allow SolarWinds to suddenly manage DS3 circuits or routers or hubs or other things. Okay. All right. I hope that's a little clearer. Now let's go to the next slide here. People are telling me to speed up a little bit. So I think we've actually covered this slide. The road to managed networks and why SNMP protocol and the value of MIBs makes this somewhat manageable and a lot easier than using proprietary, not open, you know, protocols for network management. As I had already said, there are thousands of devices, therefore thousands of MIBs. And this is essentially what Matt had asked earlier. A Cisco device with a DS3 interface will have a DS3 MIB file for it. And Juniper also has a MIB file. The difference is that Juniper may have implemented X number of those attributes, Cisco may have implemented Y number of those attributes. And you simply load that DS3 MIB file into the SNMP manager, and it's ready to talk to that device. Now, there's some discovery process as to which ones have been implemented and so on like that, but that's a straightforward process. So similarly, for all the next to last bullet there, we do the same thing for all the other devices. We load these MIB files into the SNMP manager, which is part of the network management system. And you know, in theory, voila, you have a managed network, just by virtue of the fact that you get the MIB files from the device manufacturers, you load them into your network management software, and you can manage that device. That's why you always want to buy managed devices, managed products, rather than unmanaged. So that's one of the niceties, or you can incorporate it into your network management system. Okay, so now, next, I was going to transfer to Alan, who is our software expert, who built some of our SNMP agents compatible with the DS3 MIB file. So Sanjeev, if we could transfer control to Alan, he can explain specifically this particular MIB file and the object identifier associated with, for example, in this case, I'm just following through on the same attribute that I was talking about earlier, which is the DSX3 transmit clock source. Sanjeev, could you transfer to Alan, please?
Hi, my name is Alan Ramsen. I worked with SNMP for quite a while, so I know a lot of details, so I will explain this particular definition for a managed object in DS3 MIB file. MIB file contains variety of objects. Usually it is a collection of scalar objects, tables, and notifications, which in turn contain variables or objects which carry information about events. This particular object is scalar object, and it has object identifier, DSX3 config entry ending with sub identifier 11. The object is of type integer. It means that it is expressed in a 32-bit sign value. There is a variation of integer called enumerator, where the set of valid values is limited. In this particular case, there are only three values supported, which describe clock status. Value allowed is 1, 2, and 3, which is loop timing, local timing, and through timing. And there is one item which describes it is read-only variable or it is modifiable. This one is read-write, meaning that manager may modify this attribute. It means that you can really control the device and change clock source on the device. And the description is extremely important part. It is mostly for people, but sometimes can be used for very, very smart manager to understand the semantics, how exactly it works. But it is very important in some cases read very carefully description to understand exactly what is this attribute about. Next slide shows really variable which is contained in the notifications. This variable carries information about alarms on the death tree line. Alarms really expressed by combination of bits. It can be one or more bits set. For example, it can be a yellow alarm and maybe some other alarm, let's say DSX 30, DX3 other failure. Then combination will be the value of this attribute will be other failure 512 plus yellow remote alarm 2, so the value of variable will be 514, meaning two alarms present at the same time. And there is very special bit value no alarm 1, which means that, and it should be no other bit set. It means that device line is in good condition, no alarms are present. This variable or this attribute is sent with notification on DS3 line only when status changes. Otherwise, we would have avalanche of notifications, which is not acceptable for managing large networks. Usually notifications are used very sparingly to really bring attention to abnormal event, and it is extraordinary event. It is not normal operation. Because we handle both these three alarms and these one alarms, it's there is very important definition how notifications should be present. DS1 alarms are present only if there are no existing DS3 alarms, because it can be 21 T1 lines, 28 T1 lines in one T3 line. And if alarm is present on T3, it will be accompanied with 28 alarms on T1, which will be avalanche of alarms. We want to avoid this. That's why it's very important sometimes to understand cooperation of several MIPs, not just single MIP.
Okay. Thank you, Alan. Sure. Appreciate that. And we will now just kind of recap. I think we've probably dwelled on this MIBs and OIDs. I hope you got the idea here, and that is there is this very brief language. Well, first of all, there is this machine and human readable format. Let me go back here. See, this is very important here. The machine, the brevity is in the OID value. You see there, you can see this very brief way of denoting an object identifier, 1.3, 0.6, 0.1, 0.2, 0.1, 0.10, 0.30, 0.5, 0.1. So that methodology is used in this SNMP world architecture to convey via this tree. Those numbers define the branches of this tree and actually narrow down to this particular object, this attribute and object identifier, which is what? A transmit clock source of DS3. Now that sounds like a very unique attribute, right? But it's for DS3. It's under something called transmission. It's part of some other branch. So this whole architecture, this large tree branch architecture, has been established by SNMP authority, and there's very little need to reinvent this wheel, and this actually this is called ASN1 type of formatting, and it's what the power of this SNMP architecture is. In addition to being machine readable, it is also human readable, because it gives you, like Alan said, very important text information about this attribute, which you should read, and as if you're a system engineer, understand and determine whether or not this attribute should be implemented in the SNMP agent. And the SNMP manager will discover whether you have or not and determine whether what the value of that is. Okay, so that is attributes and object identifiers, MIB information base. This is just a little snapshot of what is in the DS3 MIB file. Okay, so this particular slide just showed you that when you were interested only in alarms, traps, we're only interested in that, and there's a very compressed bit position methodology for conveying those alarms. What GL has done, GL Communications has done, is we have all of these protocol analyzers. We have a vast array of protocol analyzers, from physical layer analyzers to ISDN protocol, SS7, wireless, infrastructure protocol analyzers, SIGTRAN. I'll just give you some of the IP. So this vast array of protocol analyzers that we have, each one of those analyzers can have this SNMP notification, SNMP agent built into it, and provide information in the same architecture if the customer is interested. It certainly is available for all of the TDM technologies, the TDM transmission technologies, but it's also available for all the Ethernet, our packet analyzers, which is the where the future lies. That's what this is trying to show you, that we built this SNMP capability into all of our protocol analyzers. We've already discussed what a MIB is and what an object identifier is, so I'm going to skip through this and not bore you. Again, we've already discussed this from an SNMP point of view. You know, these RFC MIBs define the whole nature of the attributes, and it's as simple as loading that MIB file into the SNMP manager. We already discussed what an object identifier is in great detail, okay? And we also showed you that this very brief way of representing an object identifier and its value is through this object, this decimal point methodology. It's what gives the scope of SNMP, actually. Okay. And this, again, is the same thing that we just discussed a few minutes ago, but shown in a different manner. The message sequence is shown. We're not going to dwell on this right now. We're running behind a little bit here. The MIB tree library, again, this is what we've been talking about. The alarms here in the middle of this slide is showing you the alarms. And actually, when those alarms are activated, you get these SNMP messages, which is you see on the right. And that is a breakdown of those messages showing you, see, the trap V2, these are timestamp messages that show you the change in the line status of the alarms. So I know that that's a little bit hard to follow, but this is how one would convey changes in the events. Okay. All right. So now, this is slide 18, and I'm going to briefly go over this and then hand it over to Matt and help Matt explain our implementation of SNMP within our vast array of protocol analyzers. Let me kind of get you going, Matt, on this particular slide here. So our protocol analyzers for monitoring for example, the physical layer of T3s and T1s and even Ethernets is based on monitoring these physical layer alarms. Now, one of the things that distinguishes what we have done with regard to in terms of others is that we've combined. We're able to monitor both DS3 alarms and DS1 alarms simultaneously, basically tens of DS3s and all of the DS1s within those DS3s through this architecture, which essentially, let me go back to one of the previous slides here, slide 6, to show you what we're talking about there. Yeah, so our architecture allows us to not only look at the physical layer of the DS3, but also inside the DS3, which is composed of DS1s and DS0s. So here we can, through some software versatility, we're able to monitor literally hundreds of T1s, thousands of DS0s simultaneously. So we brought all of this SNMP alarm capability, detection capability, to bear on very high dense circuits, literally tens of DS3s and hundreds to thousands of DS1s and DS0s. So let me go back.
So, yeah, well, thank you, Vijay. And, yeah, it's, what we want to do now is kind of just give you a little overview. And the intention of the webinar was not to dwell on our products, per se, but we wanted to give you a little overview of an exciting project that we just completed. And it involved what we're showing here on the screen, which was this sort of DS3 box that was able to monitor many DS3s as well as the DS1s within them, okay? And it was being managed, of course, by an SNMP manager. And, you know, we developed this for a particular customer, and we were excited about the project, so we wanted to show a few slides on how that is. This particular slide just gives a very high-level graphical, you know, depiction of our analyzers at multiple locations here. You can see site 1 to site N, and how they are getting incorporated into an SNMP managed network. So just a graphical depiction of that. The product that we in the piece of hardware that we ended up developing was a 2U rack mounted USB, we call it USB T3E3 analyzer. So USB is used for the controlling of the analyzers from a host PC or computer. So what we ended up doing was stacking multiple of these 19-inch custom rack mount enclosures and monitoring many DS3s, bidirectional DS3s. So this is just a small description, a picture of that. I'll get into a little bit more detail in the coming slides. Another photograph of the actual boxes, where you can see the BNC connectors. So the DS3s, there's a TX and RX connector for each DS3, of course. And the project that we were working on and working with is an RX only type project. So we were non-intrusively monitoring a bunch of DS3 circuits. And so we were only utilizing in this particular project the RX ports. So we were using BNC cables to connect to our product, and you know they're numbered sequentially, as you can see, you know, from left to right, and port 1 to port 12, and we're again monitoring both the east and the west direction of a full duplex DS3. Now, one thing to mention about our product, our DS3 analyzers, is they're rack mountable. Of course, you can see that. This is actually a picture of the backside of them, and they require a what I call a host PC. So, and that's via a USB connection to a host PC at the bottom of the picture there. Now, what does that host PC do? Well, it's kind of there for some administrative type things, local access if you need it. If you're in a lab and you want to look at the local GUI, these products have a local Windows-based GUI that you can look at. You know, the critical processing actually occurs on the DS3 unit itself. So the host PC is really used for administrative things and GUI-related things. So the DS3 product itself, you know, again, has most of the critical processing for analyzing the DS3, and it's a product that it's a field programmable product. So it's an FPGA, it has FPGA intelligence built into it. Okay, so that's basically what we wanted to say about our product there. Just a very simple screenshot of DS3 monitor windows. So this is looking at the physical layers of each of the DS3s. In this picture, we're showing 12 of them. This is just one way to show it within our local GUI there. And you can see the alarm window, or the alarm indications, all of the green LEDs are the alarms, the loss of sync, loss of frame, AIS, and etc. As well as the frequency of the DS3 down below there, the level of the DS3 that we're monitoring, and any other layers like frame errors and so forth. So this product locally, you know, irrespective of SNMP, has a built-in GUI that comes with it, and you can log all of these DS3 alarms and all of these T1 alarms or DS1 alarms within the DS3 all locally, or you can be, you know, pushing them via SNMP to a managed SNMP system. Okay, so it's just one example here. I just wanted to kind of give you a highlight of the actual application GUI. Now, Vijay may be able to help me a little bit here, but what we're showing here is, you know, our software-based demultiplexer application. So we're monitoring the physical DS3, but we're actually able to dive deeper into the DS1s and monitor physical layer alarms on the DS1s, and provide all of those alarms as well. So if DS1 15 on DS3 number 8 is showing an alarm, we will see that. Okay, so we have access to all of those things. So that it's just a screenshot to show you what our capabilities are, but we're looking at all DS1s within the DS3s, and this is how to configure that and so forth. Very quickly, not to dwell on this because it's just the configuration file or some information about when we do connect to the SNMP manager and so forth, we have to configure the DS3. There's a little file there on our DS3 box to indicate some specific things about the box that's being shown here. Okay, IP address of the manager, the local system, etc. So go through that. Now, what Vijay briefly mentioned earlier, which was, you know, all of our products, you know, across the board, T3s, T1s, E1s, Sonnet-based products, all of our products have a very familiar protocol analyzer application built into them. So this screenshot shows that. This is one specifically for T3 physical layer protocol analysis. So it's all physical layer things. But let's say you're monitoring on a T1, an SS7 network, or let's say you're monitoring on an IP connection, a SIP protocol. All of our protocol analysis variants and so forth, all of the different protocols basically use this particular screen, this GUI. So everything looks similar to this, just the protocol is different and it gets represented by which one you select. So this is just a screenshot of that, just to give you If you're familiar with our products, which some of you may be, you're probably very familiar with this particular screen. Okay. Now, specifically within the SNMP, the T3 SNMP message generation, this particular screenshot is showing a little bit of the particulars of that, where it's showing, you can see there on the screenshot, the T3 alarm indication. So this is now a little bit digging a little deeper in how we're actually doing it and how we're sending this message over to the network manager. It's indicating we have to provide the alarm, of course, which alarm it is, and we have to provide the port number and so forth specifically, because we're monitoring many things. So this is kind of showing you some of the particulars on that, with an IP address, the alarm indication, the port number that we're actually seeing the alarm on, and so forth. I think at this point, that's probably enough information to tell you about this screen, but it's just showing you a little a screenshot of that. Okay, and you can see up above, VJ had talked about port numbers there earlier, 161 and 162. You can see it's highlighted there at the top, sort of middle of the screen. We're using 162, so that is a notification or a trap being sent to the manager. Okay, so again, within our GUI, you know, if you're locally watching and controlling and viewing our DS3 analyzer locally there with, via the host PC, you can actually dig deep into the T1 alarms or the E1R, DS1 alarms of all of those DS1s that are within the DS3. So this is showing you a very, you know, very high number of DS1s here. I think we're probably monitoring, yeah, at the bottom we're saying 12 received DS3s, so, which is probably 6 bidirectional DS3s we're monitoring, okay? So you can actually see the T1s. If you look there, it says one in the middle of the screen, 163:326. It's actually the 163rd T1 or DS1 within what we're monitoring at that location. Okay, so that's just our GUI there. If you're local, you can see all of that. And again, with this product hooked up to the SNMP management system, all of those traps, if an alarm popped up on that, would be sent to that management system and then incorporated into that. Okay. Again, very quickly, this is just the SNMP DS1 configuration. I showed you briefly earlier the DS3. This is the DS1 within our product. And again, the soft T1E1. So now we're talking about, again, this is our protocol analyzer screen, which you saw before and you may be familiar with. I showed you before the DS3 physical layer application where it was monitoring DS3 alarms. This is showing you now at the DS1 level, so T1NE1, okay? And then on and off will get indicated there and it'll pop up on the screen. That trap gets sent to the SNMP manager. Okay, it's a blurry screenshot here, but what we were trying to show was something similar to what I previously showed you at the DS3 level. This is now the a DS1 message generation. So again, some slightly different information there, but again, we have to indicate to the manager what alarm it was, what port number, and so forth. And that's what we're doing here with this screenshot. So I quickly went through this last slides for you. I hope it wasn't too quick, but I was trying to honor our 1 hour commitment, and we're right at the 1 hour mark here. I think this was a good webinar to show you a little bit about what SNMP was, gave you a lot of information about SNMP, and just touched on our product a little bit and how we're incorporating it here at GL. But again, thank you very much. Thank you, VJ. Thank you, Alan. The three of us will hang around for a while and address all questions. So let us know if you have any. And Sanjeev, thank you very much for the administration portion. And if you have any questions, Sanjeev, please forward them to us here.
Yeah, I have a question from one customer. I'll just unmute him.
Hi, GL team.
Hi, Prashant.
Please I had a question regarding, since this is a get response mechanism, HTTP mechanism. So what are the ideal polling time intervals that we keep in SNMP manager when it's going for the query to the agent, any device, routers, which is anything like that? Because in many times I've seen that there's a congestion, and I don't know, I'm not able to track it, because there may be a very heavily loaded server, and then they say that this frequent polling is disturbing the network connection. So what should be the ideal polling interval, and is it possible that SNMP queries can disrupt the network and increase the load on it? Thank you.
Yes. Usually, you rely on asynchronous notification for abnormal events when you need to react really quickly. And polling is kind of secondary. Usually, you don't poll devices more often than once per minute. But probably the minimum I would use is several seconds, not definitely multiple times per second. I would try to avoid it. And also, usually good idea not to walk entire MIP tree, because it can be very data intensive, but to get only local information, because it will take very little time, for example, to get status of T3 lines. But if you get entire T3 MIP, it will be more consuming. So the bottom line, I would try to get polling as rarely as it is necessary for quick detection of conditions you are monitoring, and try to localize, not to query everything, but only essential parts.
Okay, thanks, Alan. Thanks, Vijay, for the answer. I'll try and optimize my network SNMP manager, and let me include as to what can be done on that part. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. It was a good question. I think lots of system engineering is involved in that activity, actually. But yes, any other questions, Sanjeev?
No, Vijay.
Okay, we'll hang around for a little bit if anyone has a question. I see there's some attendees still around. So if you do have a question, we'll be here for a few minutes, and please let us know. I mean, to follow up on that first question, Vijay, I mean, and what you were saying, it seems logical to me that legacy networks like these DS3, T1, DS1 networks, which are fairly stable with alarms, the equipment should be set up in sort of this asynchronous or alert or trap mode, I guess, in how it reports, so that, you know, you may pull it every so often just to see that it's still there or something, but you know, they should be set up in this trap mode. Is that generally our recommendation?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, because those are usually, hopefully, they're reliable networks. These packet networks are very dynamic, and I think the major concern there is usually load, how congested or how not congested it is, and there you do need to, do some system engineering to understand, you know, you have to understand your network, and maybe you do need to do a query response type of, you're interested in graphs, right? Load network load graphs at different points in the network and so on. So there, querying is probably very important Yes. Depending on what you're after, right?
Okay. I just wanted to interrupt that what Vijay said. Sorry for that. Actually, the point for me asking this question is for the part of network failure, we have traps. That's okay, and that's fine. That's perfectly mm-hmm. working. But we want to know about the, since it's a telecom network, this is a telecom network device, so we want to know what time the load is high, what time the load is less. Okay. And so another question I want to put in here is it possible to program something or put in a script there so that the polling interval can be sized, like in night hours it can be more, in morning hours it can be less, or something it can be done? Is there a proper way, a proper approach to know the correct data?
I think there is. I think you have to kind of get familiar with your network and the characteristics of your network and tune your algorithms for monitoring accordingly. But I think it depends a lot on your network, what kind of network you have, what type of bandwidth it's handling, and that really depends on the history of your of your network and the number of devices that are there, the traffic distribution, time of day. It's a very I think your question is very good, but it's also very difficult to answer because it is so specific to the network topology, the network characteristics, the devices that are in the network, the load on the network, the capacity on the network, and so on. And that's what makes, of course, these packet networks so challenging, because it's not, they are very subject to loads, congestion, quality, right? You might be interested in voice quality, for example, or data quality, or all these types of parameters that are constantly varying. But I would say that managing or monitoring packet networks is probably essential. It's almost absolutely necessary.
I can add a little bit to this, how to optimize this. A lot of agents support multiple versions of SNP. There are three versions currently. Version 1, which is deprecated, old, highly discouraged to use. Version 2 and version 3. Version 2 and 3 have provisions for much more efficient polling mechanism using GET bulk requests. It can be as much as tenfold more performance than SNP V1 queries. That's why if you know which agent support version 2, I would make sure you configure your SNP manager using only V2 if possible, if agent supports both versions, 1 and 2. This will tremendously increase performance of polling, because mostly performance does not depend as much on the amount of data you transfer, but number of back and forth messages, because it is UDP sending request, receiving response, and delays because of this, not because of amount of data transferred. That's why using SNP V2 and V3 for performance is paramount.
Okay, Alan. Thank you for that. I'll see what is my SNMP manager. I suppose it supports version 2C. It supports, but I also have to check the device as to whether it supports, because I'm using Dialogic Botnet 2020 media gateway for the voice for the TDM based network, and I'm having a SIP based server. So thank you. I'll just look into those things.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thank you, everybody. I think we can close this session now.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Sanjeev. Bye.
Thank you, Vijay.